Thanks, Murray. That was a much kinder introduction than I deserve. You know, I have to tell you, some of you know me well, I've always had three resolutions that have guided my career. First, stay away from the Chinese language, it's too damn hard to learn. And second, never follow Uwe Reinhardt, because he is not only a friend and a mentor, he's the funniest health economist in the history of civilization. And so I'm not even going to try to tell jokes. But the third rule that's always governed my career is stay away from drug pricing. It's too damn hard. It's just like the Chinese language. And so I don't know exactly. Can you hear me okay? This doesn't seem okay. So I don't know exactly when it all started, but roughly around December, a number of different people came to me and said, you really ought to think about this. And I have to credit John Rother, because he was way out in front of most of us, because he had the courage and the stomach to figure out what was going on and created that campaign for sustainable drug pricing, which got everybody's attention and made me start thinking. But other people said, you know, Len, you ought to really think about this because you haven't dealt with drugs before, and so it would be a good thing to have a fresh face. Okay, fine. So I start reading, and I swear, every paper I read, I felt like I should read at least two more. So if you think about it mathematically, I read for a month and I'm 2 months behind. I read for 2 months and I'm 4 months behind. It's unbelievably complicated. It's not for the faint of heart. But it is absolutely necessary because of all the reasons that we've heard about so far. I mean, there's just no way in hell we can afford this. Now, the good news is Tony set this up so well to start the morning, I can skip a lot of slides. And Uwe, how can you possibly thank him enough for giving me all that introduction? I'll just say I'm going to spend a very little amount of time on the bargain we have struck and the fact we can't afford it, because you know all that already. I want to talk a fair bit about some economics of what I think the real choices are, and then lay out for you an option which I think is new, and it certainly, to me, makes sense as an economist and may make sense as a political economist and may even make sense as a moral philosopher, and you can decide if it's feasible. So you know the bargain we've struck. We sort of give monopoly in exchange for the hope that we'll have competition. And it's true, and it's important to remember, because this actually affects the way drug companies have chosen to think about the world, and you can't blame them for this. There's not much money left in investing in making a new small molecule drug. 85% generics, and that market is relatively competitive. So that's driving the push to invest in the large molecule biologics. I just would like to point out one little fact here. We finally approved our first biosimilar in March of 2015, and the drug it competes against was launched in 1991. So that kind of sums up how little real competition we have here. And just so you know, as soon as the new drug was declared legal for sale, Amgen, the owner of the branded drug, decided that, well, you know, 24 years of being monopoly is not enough. We're going to sue and try to stop this for some more time. And they will, of course, be successful for a while. Tony showed you this. I won't belabor the point other than to say it's scary. This is also from that same report from Express Scripts. And I just want to point out this one little set of facts. A 65% increase in the number of patients with more than $50,000 in drug cost in 1 year, and a 193% increase in patients who had more than $100,000 cost in 1 year. So this is kind of big. And just to belabor the point, this is cumulative percentage. These are percentage of the population. 0.2% of the population spends more than 50%, and they now spend 16% of total drug spend. That's roughly a tripling in 1 year. So it's a serious problem. And these drugs all have two things in common. I cannot pronounce any of them, and they cost $100,000 at least. Okay, and that's kind of the point. They were all launched in 2012, and that sets up the fact that drug spending in 2014 was over 13%, and we're now spending 10% of total spend on drugs and total health spending, used to be 5. And this is the chart Uva showed, and just to drive it home, if you have just 3% of your population getting something cost $100,000, it's going to raise premiums by $3,000. So that's really kind of why we're here. I would also say we're here, Sovaldi absolutely got us here. And the thing about Sovaldi, it is a perfect example because A, I can pronounce it, and B, it cures hepatitis C. It sets up the conflict perfectly. And, you know, the other little fact you should know in case you don't is they've actually agreed to sell in India for $900 per episode, which tells you something about the marginal cost. And they made a cool 48% on sales in 2014. Okay, and 2014, of course, there was some competition finally. There are some discounts, you know. I can't remember now if it was Tony or Uva had the 50% discount going on, and they still made this much money. It's truly impressive. Okay, so why are drug prices so high? Well, you will hear people say it's because we've got to recoup costs. But you know, what's kind of interesting when you talk to real economists, and that's, I would say, at least half the papers I read in this literature, which is voluminous and overwhelming, the real economists always say, well, you know, sunk cost shouldn't affect my optimal pricing today. They are sunk. What's optimal pricing today, as Uva said, is a function of what the market will bear, that is what people are willing to pay, and your marginal cost. So this argument is actually being used less and less and less, and Sovaldi has never said it. They've never said it, okay? What more people are saying more often now is, well, it's all about capturing value because you see I'm saving you so much money from other possible treatments and so forth. And there is some truth to that. You got to be careful about the math, but there is some truth to that. But I would submit to you, and again, I follow Ernie Berndt and a bunch of other people way smarter than me. What's really going on here is that drug pricing and drug revenues are funding today's research and marketing plans, and let's not forget they do spend roughly twice as much on marketing as they do on R&D. And I would say what's going on, obviously in the Sovaldi case and some other cases, is the investors are hoping for monopoly returns. Everybody wants to get rich. I personally would prefer to be rich too. I would like it if Kaiser would decide to pay me $1 million for this talk. I don't think it's going to happen. Okay, but so everybody wants to get rich, and part of it is, let's be clear, everybody's scared about the healthcare system's changes. Everybody's afraid that their part of the pie is going to be taken away. And so I think it's fair to say part of what's going on is they fear that someday, surely, the people will wise up and start imposing some kind of price controls. I want to make as much as I can before that happens. That is a non-trivial part of what's going on. Okay, so what are the policy options? Well, you know, if you listen to the people who support the industry, we should accept our fate, read their speeches, and just move on. You know, after all, it's only now 10% of spend. It's still only 10% hospitals or more. We could impose price controls, and by that I mean specific dollar amounts, like a fee schedule we do in Medicare for physicians or hospital DRGs, et cetera. And I would submit to you, while what I'm going to suggest has some elements of regulation, pure price controls in this country's context are not politically feasible and probably not a good idea, okay, for all kinds of reasons, the simplest of which are it's too complicated. But I would also say some people are saying, well, why don't we just let Medicare bargain? It is true that the PBMs have ability to bargain, and they do in the cases where they do have the power to do so. They do that. But as you all probably know, one of the problems in the Medicare program are the Part B drugs that are administered by physicians and therefore outside the PBM reach, their fee-for-service Medicare. And that's really where the cancer drugs are, and that's really what's driving this incredible cost. So some people say, why not let Medicare bargain and start being smart? And I put that in the class of, it's a good idea, Not in this Congress is that going to happen, so let's move on. And then what you see, and you begin to see a lot of creative ideas that have come from mostly really smart people who know a lot more than I do about all this, and I defer to them. And I'll just say this is a class of solutions. Joe Stiglitz thinks we should have basically prizes. Other people say we should allow them to get grants on competition. And the basic idea behind all these proposals is to substitute for the private capital required to take you through phase one, phase two, phase three, substitute public capital. So if you think about it, if you put public capital in place of private capital, then you could charge a lower price and still earn the same rate of return you are today. Okay? I look at that as a very clever way of dealing with what seems to be the political constraints upon us. But then I think a little harder and I say, are you kidding me? We're going to add a new thing for which we're investing public capital and we're giving it to the drug companies? I don't think so. Okay, so it's a clever idea that I don't think will ever happen. A lot of emphasis, and this does make a tremendous amount of sense, we could do this, do a much better job of matching patients with particular specific drugs so that the probability of actually having an impact is much higher. There's a lot of promise there, you know, and I would just say it's a good idea and great good luck, and I can't believe there's a whole lot we can say, but it would certainly help a lot of people. Then you're going to hear from Peter Bach later, who has done two, he's basically responsible for two, he's that smart, okay? Just say no to low-value drugs, that is, if something's not going to extend life very long, and it's going to cost a lot of money, we're just not going to do it. And actually, he led a movement at Sloan Kettering to do so, and he is trying to be what I would call an example to Medicare and calling for that sort of thing, and Lord knows you can't oppose that logic. He also recommends indication-specific pricing because there are many cases where a drug might actually be effective to extend life, say, for 6 to 9 months for one particular kind of cancer, but it's being used for other kinds of cancers where it's not extending life very much at all, and so you really should be more careful about that. That's kind of akin to this, just do better matching. And then Joe Newhouse and Richard Frank, who are probably the smartest health economists, that are not in UVA's orbit in the short run, propose in the Medicare case, give Medicare the chance to do binding arbitration, which means if a company comes in, they're the only seller of the drug. The drug is for cancer, so it's something that's really hard to say no to. At least let it go to binding arbitration like baseball players do, and you have a neutral party pick a price. Those are all, I would say, good logical solutions. They all make sense. We need so many arrows in the quiver, I would try them all. Okay? But on the theory that A, a lot of these aren't going to happen, and B, even if they do, they're not going to save big bucks, I decided to get a little creative. And to do that, you got to go back to economics. So I apologize, but UVA just took you through Econ 101 again, so you should feel better about this. And mine are not as pretty. So, you know, you'll have to deal with that. But anyhow, I just want to convey what I'm talking about here, and I will give you a little bit of economics. So if you remember, there are two kinds of demand curves. There are elastic demand curves and inelastic demand curves. Okay, and elastic means that price is very responsive, right? And inelastic means it's not so responsive. Because it means basically the consumers of the good for an inelastic product don't have any substitute. Well, it turns out it's technically true. If the demand is inelastic, as it is for most of these cancer drugs, if not all of them, and for many of the biologics in general, if, and certainly think about, you know, Sovaldi, you can cure or you can die of liver failure, so it's pretty inelastic. You'll pay what it takes. If demand is actually inelastic, the profit-maximizing price is the very highest price you will pay. Why? Because it's never, and you can always make more money raising price and lowering demand. That's the definition of an inelastic demand curve. Price goes up, quantity goes down, but not enough to offset the higher price. And so what I'm trying to convey here is the absolute maximum price imaginable. And I submit to you, that's actually the highest price that Gilead could imagine. That's what they picked. And so this little curve is meant to say there are this many people who are willing to pay that highest price. They exist. They are the people who are about to die of liver failure. They are the people with very, very good insurance who weren't paying attention to how much this stuff cost, and so forth. And so what's going on here, as Uwe pointed out, sorry, let me go back. I don't want P2. Okay. There. Okay. What's going on here is they charge this price, they sell that much, and I'm letting this be the profit that they earn at launch. Okay, so the difference between price and cost, and I'm basically rolling everything up into here because I think what you should do here, this should be the marginal cost of production, but it should include the cost of capital or a normal rate of return, and it should include equilibrium amount of R&D because it should be R&D funds current and not past. Okay, so the point is, this is the profit, and when you think about what is the value to society of a new good, it is the sum of the profit that the firm takes home plus the consumer surplus that flows to the demanders. Well, in this particular launch price case, which I submit to you conveys the norm in the current world for biologics and for things like Sovaldi, there is no consumer surplus. It is all producer surplus. So the social welfare, the sum of these two things, is only profit. Okay? Now, over time, if we're smart and lucky, we get some competition. And that competition comes from the entry of a biosimilar, if we can pull that off. And that entry would drive price down to P2. We would get Q2 demanded. And then you would see we would have some consumer surplus. There would be people willing to pay more than what they have to pay. Profit is still pretty big. So the social welfare, the value of the good, goes up to this amount, the profit plus the consumer surplus. There's still a little bit of deadweight loss left, and that's why what we really want in the long run is for price to fall all the way down to the competitive, to the price, to the cost. And when you do that, social welfare, there's no profit, and everything is consumer surplus. That's a competitive equilibrium. Okay? So what am I trying to say here? I'm trying to say that over time, with competition, you will get more social welfare, you will get more people consuming the product, and a bigger share of the social welfare will shift from profit to consumer surplus. So it goes to consumers. Well, the point is, policy is about setting the rules to do two things. Affect the total social welfare, because you want as much social welfare as you can get, and the distribution of it. Now, the point about price discrimination is very important because theoretically, a monopolist could, if they were able to, charge different prices to every demander and thereby capture all of the social welfare as profit. And the social welfare would be just as much as in a perfectly competitive case. That is a theoretical possibility. And as an economist, technically you got to be indifferent about how you get to social welfare as long as you get the competitive equilibrium. What's complicated about price discrimination in the drug case is that, think about it this way, America is the one paying the big price, okay? And what you see is that, you know, typically for situations, quantity goes up a hell of a lot more. Well, we're the biggest market by far. So it's really easy to give the French a deal. It's really easy to give the Luxembourgians, whatever the hell they are, a deal. Okay? And you know, you see what I'm trying to say? But what they worry about is having to change this. Okay? So all I'm trying to say is, what I want to do, and the whole point of this paper and the whole point of this conversation, is to convince you that we're going to be better off if we can start at a lower launch price, so that we start with a greater social welfare than we would have had in the monopoly period. And the only way I know to do that in a world where biologics are dominant is to make the grant of exclusivity contingent on pricing behavior. In other words, right now, they're able to do what they want, And because they have the patent for a while and exclusivity for 12 years, thank you to the ACA, they can be a monopoly for a very long time. They never have to move. They can dabble with price discrimination in these little bitty markets, but they're not gonna, that's not going to help us. Okay? So, here's my proposal. It's America. You can price where you want. But if you pick a price high enough, we will not give you the exclusivities that follow the launch. Right? You know how it works. You get a patent, but you get the patent really early in the drug development stage because you got to protect your intellectual property of how this thing is made. But the problem with biologics, they have a point, it takes us so long to get through all the testing that the effective patent life is relatively short. So to a biologic producer, exclusivities which follow marketing extend the monopoly for a longer period of time and allow you to keep earning that high profit for a longer period of time. So they care a lot about exclusivities. Well, what if we said, you know, what we really want is to start at P2. We start at a lower price and everybody gets, we get more social welfare, more consumer surplus. Make them perform as if there is competition, even when there is not. Okay, and we do that by giving them a choice. Hey, it's America, there's always a choice. If you want a price like you want, go fine, but then you will not allow, you will not get the exclusivities that will last this extra, in the biologic case, 12 years. So what I'm trying to do is use economics and policy to channel the self-interest of the drug company into the social interest of the country, which is to get launch prices down and still allow them to earn quite a fine rate of return. So how high is too high? Well, Uwe talked about Aristotle and how Aristotle figured out it's all about value. But Aristotle did talk about actually just price, and he did talk about a monopoly. He invented the term. Okay? And Aristotle wrote that actually a monopoly price is not just. What is just? The result of multiple sellers so that value would approach cost. Okay, so what would I do? I would say, look, a price is too high if the rate of return you earn, I'm doing return on sales because it's simpler, and actually I think it's way simpler to compute. Return on sales is more than 20% higher than the cost of capital for a firm with a small gain. Now let's think about that. Go back to Uwe's example. Suppose the cost of capital for a drug company is 10%. Okay, that 10%, that's what they can borrow at or what they can get capital raised for. Okay, that 10% is a reflection of an incredibly sophisticated market that can discount all the risk. That's how they pick a number to loan them money for. Okay, so all the stuff about, oh, it's a risky industry, it's true, it's riskier than some things, but the cost of capital reflects the international market judgment about how risky it is. So what I'm saying is I will give you up to 20% more than your current cost of capital. If you do that, your price is not too high. If you go above that, then you don't get to keep your exclusivities. I can't touch patent, that's in international trade. I can touch exclusivities, at least for the moment. And you could have different degrees of the profit allowed, depending on whether it was a large gain. I personally would put Sovaldi in the large gain category. It actually cures the drug, cures the disease. And again, we go from 10 to 14%, but not 50%. Okay. Now, I will also say there's probably should be a special case of a new firm that hasn't yet brought a drug to market, because those new firms don't have any revenues at the moment. They actually do have a debt they got to pay off, a venture capital loan for the R&D, so they need more. So give them 50, okay? But it's still, we're talking 15% versus 50, okay? So this will require cost accounting data to be submitted, but I would argue, although I am a little biased because I'm an economist, but I would argue the cost accounting data being submitted to either a new unit of the FDA or some other place is way simpler than trying to figure out which drug is most promising in stage one. Way simpler than trying to impose this test should be given to all patients before you give a cancer drug. So I submit to you it's actually simpler. Okay, so here's how it would kind of look. if you have vertical axis is money and the horizontal axis is time. This simply conveys you got to spend money on R&D to start. And if you launched the thing at P1, that's a profit stream you could get. If you launched it at P2, which is what I want, you get a lower profit stream. So at this point, profits is obviously greater if you charge P1 than P2. But here's the thing. P1 would generate a profit rate higher than my allowed price. So if they did that, I would take away their exclusivity. They would then earn this profit B. Okay. Now, if they went for P2, because it's a lower price than the trigger, we allow them to have their exclusivity, so they actually get to do it for a longer period of time, and they would earn C. And notice this area, C is bigger than B. Oops, sorry. C is bigger than B, and B is bigger than A, too. So I'm just trying to say, basically, mathematically, for every exclusivity period, there's a price that will get you to this equilibrium. So we can find a price exclusivity combination that will make the firm better off and give us, the society, a lower price to start. And then once you get that lower price, you are paying less forever. Okay, so what am I trying to say? We're not helpless. I the thing about living here and talking about drug policy, again, why did I avoid it for 140 years of my career? It's so hard, it's just impossible. We can't touch it. We're not helpless. Okay, we're not helpless. However, it's an important point. We will be hamstrung if the Trans-Pacific Partnership includes what some of us fear it does, which is 12 years exclusivity across the board. If you bake 12 years exclusivity into an international trade agreement, then Congress cannot go back and change it. Remember Tony's early slide about how we got from 17 to 20 years without a debate. That's because it came in a round of international trade negotiations. Once you commit to an international trade agreement, you're stuck. You essentially cede the power of Congress to address the question. Well, that's another reason to read the damn thing before we vote. But anyway, I'm telling you, that's a really, really, really big deal. Now, in my opinion, the conditional exclusivity, the policy of granting exclusivity only if you price in such a way that you earn a rate of return that's allowable, this conditional exclusivity requires less bureaucratic judgment than all the other feasible options about trying to figure out which drug to bet on. And then I would say, well, we're going to have to take a deep step and put on our big boy pants here. Pharma's not going to like any of this. And if we're not willing to take them on, it's over. But that was true before we started. Okay? Let me take questions. Yeah, that's true.
Do we have time for one question? I'm looking at the timekeepers back there.
Pick one. There's one in the back and there's one here.
Yeah.
Is it on?
Yep.
Okay. I'm Judy Wagner. I'm a private consultant. I was once with the Office of Technology Assessment back in the early 90s when the issue was how much does it cost to develop a new drug. And I wanted to raise with you the issue of reasonable pricing and the CRADAs, which was, first of all, the NIH involvement in the development of these high-priced drugs
right. Is
there at every level. In fact, Jerry Avorn just had an article in the New England Journal of Medicine outlining NIH's seminal involvement in the development of Sovaldi. Hmm. And back in the day, at least the NIH mechanisms under CRADA and perhaps under the Technology Transfer Act had a reasonable pricing clause. And in 1995, that was abandoned. This was all executive action, my understanding is, though I'm not an expert on it anymore. It was abandoned because actually at the request of Dr. Varmus, because it wasn't worth the effort. In fact, they never really tried. There were discussions. But NIH, in the era of Bernadette Healy, felt very strongly they didn't have the capacity and the knowledge base to do reasonable pricing, which is what you're asking for. I mean, your mechanism is, you know, of control is a, you know, an exclusivity mechanism. But this was an issue of can you use this patent? And that all just went down the drain. So my question is, why would it not make sense to give more control to the buyers and more ability, for example, taking away the constraint on Medicare in the Medicare Part D thing where they limit the number of, or the capability of the Medicare Part D to in those six areas, the cancer areas, et cetera. Wouldn't that make more sense and be quicker? Because in fact, what we learned at OTA 25 years ago, and then we were dead in, as an agency 3 years later, after that study came out, and some drug companies bragged that, you know, OTA was one of the their victories, the death of OTA. What we found was that R&D is like a lottery, and in fact, the cost of R&D, especially as it's evaluated with this, you know, the cost of capital and the successes, the number of entries into the lottery is driven by the size of that potential market. So when we looked, it was small molecules in certain new areas, but you know, you'd have 30 potential new molecular entities under development for one specific asthma diagnosis, for example. So
get to a question for
Len. Well, I mean, I'm really questioning whether or not your approach, which is the the cost regulation approach, is as efficient as really letting the competitive forces work on the buyer's side.
Thank you, Judy. I definitely agree with Tony. It would be far better to let the current marketplace work where it can, and those restrictions put on Congress about number in each formulary, each class, et cetera, retard that, and I'm totally in favor of loosening that. And I think the plans have to be held accountable for what happens to their people, and they have to be agreed to accept accountability for those choices. I'm totally in favor of that. What I'm worried about are the markets where they don't have any drug to play off against each other. It's a pure monopoly market. And I would submit reasonable price is a very difficult thing to define, and that's why I'm trying to define it quite precisely. It would be a particular percentage above the current cost of capital, which is a known thing. And so what you're going to have to do, and they got to fill out stuff to the SEC now, and figuring out a rate of return, I would submit, is a way easier thing than figuring out which drug is most promising. I'd say it's an empirical question. Let's let all flowers bloom, but that's my judgment. The financial calculation is 10 times simpler, and I would go back to Varmus. He didn't have the apparatus to deal with this. This has got to be created, but I think defining the reasonable rate of return to be related to the specific cost of capital makes it way simpler.
We've got one last question up front here.
Thank you. Ruth Lopat, Management Sciences for Health and George Washington University. I think it's a really appealing proposition, but I'm concerned about a couple of things. First of all, what about TRIPS?
What about
what about Article 39 of TRIPS? That is basically...
See, I only got to 6 months of reading, so I don't really know.
And what about the other sort of 27 out of 36 free trade agreements that the U.S. is signatory to, never mind the TPP?
Oh.
And the fact that not all specialty drugs are biologics and therefore only get 5 years of exclusivity, And I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be a naysayer because I actually think it's an appealing proposition. But the other thing is, what about bi-dole and march-in rights, at least for federally funded inventions? There's a law that already exists that could be used to moderate prices to some extent.
Look, that's why I put the last bullet up there. It's going to take courage to use the tools we have now, and some of the proposals like Jerry Avorn stuff on matching patients, we have those tools now. We just haven't been using them aggressively. Well, and so all I'm trying to say is, yes, I don't disagree with anything you said. 5 versus 12, 5 is better than 12, right? But I would still say they care a lot about the 5 if they're a specialty manufacturer. So conditioning the price, it's all about the launch price, I would submit. The lesson I learned, everything's about launch price.
But you've also got treaty obligations associated with that 5 years.
Yeah, but okay, then I can't change that. But, you know, I'm not sure.
To be worked out.
Yeah. If I stop the 12, I'll consider my day one, okay? That'll be the thing. All right, thank you very much.
Join me in thanking Len Nichols.